Well, amen. Thank you so much, choir and orchestra. And remember, Tuesday evening, we will be having our Christmas Eve service. You want to come be a part of that. Invite someone to come with you. Maybe you have a neighbor who is not a believer, and you could bring them to church with you Tuesday evening. It's always a great opportunity for us to come together as God's family, and also an opportunity for us to share a word of witness to those who never really hear the gospel. For those who are avid readers or maybe writers of poetry, they are familiar with something that is referred to as the couplet. And of course, a couple is referring to two things. And so a couplet is two lines of poetry that is joined by meter and sometime rhyme. And the Bible uses this idea of a couplet over and over again. For example, one of the greatest couplets that we have in Scripture is found in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 16, where the Bible tells us that great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit. That's the first couplet. It says that he was seen among the angels and preached among the Gentiles. That's the second couplet. It says that he was believed on in the world and received up into glory. That is the third couplet. I want to look this morning at another couplet as we continue our series on the miracle of Christmas, God in a manger. I want to talk about a Christmas couplet. We find it in the book of the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, beginning with verse number 8, verses 8 through 14, as we read the familiar part of the Christmas story, and we see an amazing couplet that is mentioned here. Luke's Gospel, chapter number 2, and beginning with verse number 8. The Bible says, "And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Now the couplet that we find here in this particular passage of Scripture is good news, great joy. Good news, Jesus has come, great joy for those who receive him and trust him as their Savior. You know, couplets are ideas that go together. And we certainly could say that great joy goes with good news. You know, last week I think that there were a lot of Alabama football fans that probably were rejoicing because of some good news they had heard. And the good news was that their coach, Nick Saban, had signed an extension on his contract. And so St. Nick brought to them great joy. I think that we could also say that there were some fans probably of the Texas Longhorns that also rejoiced because of what they perceived as good news. And that is that their coach, Mack Brown, resigned. You see, rejoicing has everything to do with the way that we perceive the news, whether it's good or whether it's bad. And I really think that if you and I truly understand and perceive the news that is given here in this passage of Scripture, the only thing that we can do is rejoice, because this is the greatest good news that has ever been given. So I want to center our thoughts this morning around that idea of good news. And the first thing that I want us to take note of in verses 8 through 10 is the proclamation of the good news. The proclamation of the good news. You know, any time that the White House or any other newsworthy organization sends out a press release, I'll guarantee you that there are some writers that will go over every single word of that press release to make sure that it's correct, that everything in it is accurate. And I think that in order for a press release to be a good press release, it has to be clear, it has to be to the point, and usually it's very concise. In other words, a press release is some important news that is stated with an economy of words. And I really think that we could look at what's going on here in Luke's Gospel chapter number 2, and we could refer to this as heaven's press release about the good news of the coming of Jesus Christ. And I really believe that this news fits the particular description I just gave, because it's clear, it's to the point, it's very concise. As a matter of fact, we could say that this is one of the clearest presentations of the gospel in an economy of words. Not many words are given, and yet we clearly see what the gospel, the good news of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, is all about and what its purpose is. I mean, this is amazing news that is given. This is news from another world, because the Bible says, "For I bring unto you." This is good news. It's good tidings. It's joyful news. It's of great joy. It's global news, which shall be to all people. It's nursery news, for there is born. It's personal news to you. It's breaking news this day. It's saving news, a Savior. It's messianic news, who is the Christ. And it's life-changing news, who is the Lord. There has never quite been any news that has been proclaimed like this news. So as we think about the proclamation then of the good news, I want to talk about three things about that proclamation. And the first thing that I notice is the recipients of the proclamation. Friend, I want to tell you, the supernatural announcement, that cold night near Bethlehem to the shepherds, was truly the very high point of redemptive history. Now, there had been other announcements that had been given up to this point, but there had never been an announcement that was given like was given on that night. I believe that that angel that was walking around carrying that news was about to explode within himself. You know, if the Bible says that Jeremiah the prophet said that the word of God was like a fire that was shut up in his bones, I believe that this angel would have said, "It's like a volcano that is shut up in my bones," because he was sent to proclaim that Jesus Christ was here. I mean, that angelic choir had been rehearsing time after time after time after time, and now the time had finally arrived when the great performance, the greatest performance of all, was about to be given. You know, I love to share good news, don't you? Anytime anybody asks me to go to somebody else and tell them some good news, I always look forward to doing that. But I tell you what, I don't like to be the bearer of bad news, do you? You know, I can think of many times in my ministry that I've been called upon to be the bearer of bad news. I can remember one time that I was asked to go to the home of a couple in Gulfport, Mississippi, and share with them that their teenage son had been killed in an automobile accident. I want to tell you what, I didn't want to go and be the bearer of that kind of news. But I tell you, I like to share good news. And I can just imagine the feeling that was inside of this angel that had been selected by God to go and share with the shepherds, and not only the shepherds, but the entire world, that the Savior had come who was going to deliver God's people from the guilt and the punishment of sin, that he was going to take away the fear of death and hell and the results of sin. That was the news that this angel was called upon to announce. And I'll tell you, this news, it was amazing, not simply because of its content, but also because of its recipients. It was given to the shepherds. You know, just kind of put yourself in their shoes for a moment. I believe that if you would have been a PR agent of that time, and if you would have been tasked with announcing the good news of the Messiah's birth, I think that probably the last group you would have gone to be the first group you would have shared this news with, would have been a lowly band of shepherds. I think, in fact, if you would have been that PR agent, you would have looked for some movers and shakers. You would have looked for some influential people. Maybe you would have gone to the high priest, because after all, he was the religious leader of the nation of Israel. You know, maybe you would have gone to the chief priest and the scribes because they were the master teachers of the nation of Israel. Maybe you would have gone to the Sanhedrin, who were those 70 leaders that were the theocratic leadership of the nation of Israel. Maybe you would have gone to the Pharisees, who were the religious fundamentalists of the nation of Israel in that day. Maybe you would have gone to Caesar Augustus for sure, because he was the emperor of that day. But the angel did not go to any of those folks. Instead, the angel went to a group of lowly shepherds. And friend, every time that I read that and I kind of process that, I say to myself, you've got to be kidding me. I mean, why go to a group of shepherds? Because after all, the shepherds, they were on the lowest rung of the social ladder of the Jewish nation. In fact, did you know that the religious Jews considered shepherds to be religious outcasts because their work schedule would not allow them to observe the Sabbath as was dictated by the Mosaic law? They could not do that. So they were religious outcasts. Later on, as they developed throughout the biblical days, they became those that were considered to be thieves and lowlifes. I mean, they were the very low of the low. And yet that's the one that the angel came to and announced the good news that Christ the Lord has been born. But you know, when we filter that through and we observe that through the mission of the Lord Jesus, it really makes sense that these are the ones that initially heard that message. Jesus told us what his mission was over in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, and he was really just quoting the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 61 and verse number 1. In Luke 4, 18, Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised." In other words, this message, are you listening? Say amen. It did not come to people of prestige, prominence, influence, affluence, or clout. Why not? Because those folks didn't think they needed any good news. And oh, by the way, a lot of folks in those same categories today, the prestigious and the prominent and the influential and the affluent and those of clout, think that they do not need any good news today. So this announcement came to those who were at the bottom, who knew that they were at the bottom, and they were looking up. I really believe that when we read between the lines of this announcement, that it is an accurate picture of God's salvation that is sovereignly extended toward undeserving sinners. You know, the Apostle Paul, he understood that truth. As a matter of fact, he wrote to young Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 5. He said that Christ Jesus has come into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Friend, I want to tell you, the only place that the grace of God can operate is within a heart that knows that it needs the grace of God. And just in case somebody is here today and you know that you need the grace of God, then you have the potential for receiving the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Have you ever wondered why it is that the Christmas story so resonates today with those who are the down and out, and with those who are the depressed and discouraged, and to those who are at the very end of their rope? Why does it resonate with folks like that? It is because Jesus Christ identifies with folks like that, with the poor and the maimed and the blind and the heartbroken and the ones whose lives have been ripped and shattered apart. Those are the ones that the Lord Jesus Christ comes and he identifies with. And so we see, first of all, in the proclamation, we see the recipients, and it's amazing that it was these poor, lowly shepherds. But the second thing that we see is the revelation in verse number 9. "And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid." Friend, I don't know about you, but I never tire of visualizing what may have taken place. that night. As I was thinking toward this sermon, it was toward the first part of last week. And I remember it was after dark one night, and I walked outside to roll the trash can out to the side of the road so that it could be picked up the following morning. And as I walked out, I noticed that there was this beautiful full moon. And I noticed that there were these stars that were just exploding in the sky. And the ambience of the evening produced this still quietness in my soul. And as I was just sitting outside, I'm sure Karen wondering, when in the world is this guy coming back in? Just sitting out there for a long time and looking up, I was thinking, I wonder if maybe that's what that night was like for the shepherds. Sitting out there under the amazing canopy of that Judean sky, exploding with God's created stars. Maybe they were looking at the outlines of their sheep on the hillside. Maybe one of those shepherds picked up a log and threw it in the fire, and sparks flew upward into the blackness of the night. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, with no announcement, this heavenly visitor shows up and pierces the darkness of the night, radiating light and reflecting the very glory of God. Maybe that's what it was like. And we think about the fact that it was the glory of God that was reflected, that they saw, that they identified. Boy, that adds new meaning to the Christmas story, doesn't it? Because what is the glory of God? The glory of God is the presence of God manifested as light. You see, God is spirit. God does not live in a physical body. God's spirit. And so any time that God manifested his presence to humanity, he always did so in this incomprehensible, pure light. That's always how he revealed himself to humankind. And friend, the reason that was so important that night is because it had been a long, 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 long time since the presence of God had been revealed. We know that it had been at least 400 years, longer than that, since the presence of God, which is the glory of God, had been revealed on the earth. Friend, you think about the glory of God. The Bible says that when Moses and the rest of the Israelites finished the construction of the tabernacle and furnishing it according to God's direction, the Bible says that the Shekinah cloud covered that tabernacle and the glory of God filled that tabernacle. Later on, the Bible says, as Solomon finished the construction of the temple, that the same phenomenon occurred and the glory of God filled the temple. And then the Bible tells us that it wasn't long after that until Israel sinned against God. And Ezekiel the prophet said, "And I saw the glory, the presence of God departing from the temple." Friend, that's got to be the saddest sight in the Bible, the presence of God departing from the earth. But do you realize what happened on that night? On that night, the presence of God returned to the earth. Not in a building or a tent like it had been in before, but it returned in the presence of a little baby. See, that's what was happening that night. And dear friend, what does Christmas shout? Christmas does not shout, "Here comes Santa Claus." Christmas looks at the baby and says, "Here is God." It was the presence of the living God that was wrapped up in that little baby. My, what astounding news that he has come that he might take away your sins. So we see the recipients, the revelation, but then we see thirdly the reaction. In verses 9 and 10, the angel of the Lord came upon them, the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not." You see, the lowliest class of humanity had just received the very greatest of revelation. The Bible says, understandably so, they were afraid. And I love what the angel said, "Do not fear, because I bring you good tidings of great joy." Don't be afraid, because the angel had not come to announce punishment. and judgment. The angel had come to announce good news of great joy. Good news. See, that's what the Christmas story is. It's good news. And by the way, did you ever think of it like this? When he came to announce good tidings or good news, what was he announcing? The gospel. Because what is the gospel? The gospel is good news. The gospel is that a merciful God has sent a Savior into the world to die on a cross that you could be forever forgiven of your sins. And that kind of news, friends, listen, the gospel does not bring fear. The gospel brings rejoicing. Why? It's good news. Good news. Friend, I want to tell you what, if you've been saved by the grace of God, if you have asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart, you ought to put a smile on your face and let singing and laughter reverberate in your saved soul. You have been the recipient of good news. And the only logical response is rejoicing. And friend, listen, if you have not received him into your heart, then you are a candidate for receiving him and then being able to respond with rejoicing. I don't know. I wonder about somebody. I wonder about anybody that could read the Christmas story and not just break out with a big old heart-splitting laugh. Friend, it's to produce rejoicing. So the reaction, don't you be afraid. I'm bringing you good news. So we see the proclamation of the good news. But then we see the preciousness of the good news. In verse number 10, here's the preciousness, the C part of that verse. I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to what? All people. You want to know why this news is so precious? It's because it's not limited. It's not for the favored. It's not for the few. It's not for the educated. It's not for the elite. It is for all people. That's why it's so precious. Why do we send mission teams around the world? Because the gospel is for all people, not just for a few. And did you know that it's personal? Because he says in verse number 11, for unto you is born. You just put your name in there. For unto Craig is born, unto Karen is born. Unto you is born a Savior who is Christ the Lord. I know what you may be thinking. But Pastor, I wasn't raised in some ivory tower, neither was I. You might be thinking, but Pastor, listen, I wasn't even raised in a Christian home, neither was I. But Pastor, I've done some really bad things, so have I. Friend, I want to tell you, with all of the humility of my soul, I am living proof and the greatest example there is that Jesus Christ will save and forgive anybody who will believe in his saving work on the cross. You see, friend, the gospel, listen, the gospel is not only for all people, the gospel works for all people. It works for all people. You know, you go out here and you tell a guy about George Washington or Abraham Lincoln or Martin Luther King Jr., and they may be inspired by their life, but you tell a person about Jesus Christ, and they will walk out of darkness into life, out of bondage into freedom, out of death into life. Because the message of others inspires, the message of Jesus Christ changes. And can I tell you that the message of Jesus Christ is the only thing that will work? It is the only solution there is to the problems of human living today. It really does work. And I believe that there are hundreds of people that are here today, and you verify it because it worked in your life. And you see, dear friend, if you do not know the Lord Jesus, you could be a part of that verification group today. the proclamation of the good news, the preciousness of the good news, the person of the good news. Verse 11, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. You know, any significant news always involves people. But sometimes good news for one may not be good news for others. It was good news for Alabama fans that St. Nick signed a contract. But it may not be good news for fans of other football teams in the SEC because he's a very good football coach. You know, sometimes when it comes to the idea of good news, the key player is the one who announces it. But sometimes the good news, the key player, is the one who authors it. And here what the shepherd does is the shepherd focuses the one who is the good news, the one who embodies the good news, who is Jesus Christ the Lord. And friend, I love the way that he is identified here because we see two things about the Lord Jesus that the angel identified. Number one was his office. He simply said he is Christ. And I want to tell you, when he said he was Christ, he said a mouthful there. I want to tell you, it was quite an exalted title, Christ, to give to a little bitty baby. You know, when Jesus was born, the Lord Jesus didn't wear a crown. There was no halo over his head to identify him as being somebody that was special. As a matter of fact, there were no physical marks or characteristics that would identify him as being deity, as being sovereign, as being the Messiah. In fact, we learned last Sunday morning in our study that there was nothing different about the physical body of Jesus that would identify him as being nothing but just an ordinary baby. And yet when the angel announced his birth, the angel referred to him as Christ. And friend, listen, that's important because the word Christ is the word Christos. And the word Christos is a word that means the anointed one. And back during those days, Bible days, they anointed people that were special people. So what the angel was saying was that Jesus Christ is God Almighty's anointed. People were anointed by someone in great authority. Who was the authority that anointed Jesus? God Almighty. And there are voices out there today that say, well, how in the world can you say that Jesus Christ is more important than Buddha or Muhammad or someone else? I tell you how I can tell you. God anointed him as the Christ. He is God's chosen. And when you think about the three offices in the Bible that were anointed, I want to tell you that adds special emphasis to the meaning of the name of Jesus Christ. We know that it was kings that were anointed. They would take a king and they would anoint that king with oil, and that set that king apart as being over his subjects. When the angel said Jesus is the Christ, he was saying Christ is God's anointed king who will rule and reign forever and ever. He was saying that in Jesus all authority in heaven and in earth has been given unto him. Praise God, he has a kingdom, and praise God, I'm a part of his kingdom. You see, kings were anointed. The Bible also says that priests were anointed. Priests were anointed for the purpose of being the intercessors between God and men. They spoke to men from God. They were the intercessors. And what does the Bible say about Jesus? 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 15, it says that there is one mediator between God and men, who is the man, Christ Jesus. Friends, I want to tell you, Jesus is the only one who can bring sinners to God. But thirdly, prophets were anointed. Prophets were anointed. What did prophets do? Prophets were God's spokesman. Prophets spoke for God. Let me give you two verses. Listen to the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, but hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, Jesus, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world." Friend, I want to stand here unapologetically and say Jesus Christ alone is God's prophet, priest, and king. There are no other ways to heaven. There are no voices of equal authority. Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone speaks for God. And when Jesus speaks for God, it really doesn't matter what anybody else says. It really doesn't matter what anybody else's opinion is. Jesus is God's spokesman. Jesus and Jesus alone speaks truth. What Jesus says about an issue is not up for debate. It doesn't matter if we like it or not. You know, we've seen, and this is not in my notes because I really don't have any, but this is not. But I didn't write this down to say it, but I'm going to say it. You know, we've seen evidence this past week in the news that not everybody believes that Jesus Christ's voice is authoritative. You know, Phil Robertson, the patriarch of Duck Dynasty, was being interviewed by GQ magazine and was asked his opinion about homosexuality. He gave his opinion based on the Bible because he believes the voice of Christ is authoritative. So he said what the Bible says. And the result of saying what the Bible says, Phil Robertson was called a bigot, a hate monger. You know, the GLAAD organization that is the watchdogs for the homosexual lifestyle to make sure that no one in the media says anything critical about the homosexual lifestyle. So they just pushed and they pushed and they pushed. And you know what happened? The A&E network said that they're going to take him off the air or suspend Phil indefinitely for giving, quote, his opinion. You know, I for one am up to here with that crowd. I am up to here with that crowd who thinks that their opinion is the only one that counts. You know, those who scream tolerance the loudest are the most intolerant group around unless you agree with their perverted opinion. Friend, listen, I'm telling you, that opinion is perverted because it goes against the authority of God's Word. And it's time for God's people to say enough is enough. Enough is enough. You know, A&E says they're not going to bring Phil back. Well, I can tell you, as for me and my house, we're done with A&E Network. We're done. So good. Well, that matches that one. Well, that look good. I'm going to start preaching in camo. I tell you, I'm going to stand for a Christian named Phil Robertson, who just said what Jesus said. I'm not going to back up. I'm going to speak the truth every opportunity I get. I'm going to do it in love, but I'm going to speak the truth. And GLAD or any other organization is not going to control my speech. My opinion is based on thus saith the Lord. That is the authoritative voice. I like this. I tell you, my son-in-law loaned it to me, but it's mine now. Well, how in the world, what do I add after that? There's one last thing, though, that's important. Not only in this description do we see his office, but we also see his identity. Because he is referred to as Christ, what? The Lord. The Lord. It's the word kurios. And that word kurios was used so often in the New Testament until it became a symbolism for the name of God. I mean, it was just like saying the name God. And so when the angel said, his name is Jesus, he's Christ, the Savior who is Lord, he was saying that the baby in the manger is God. Friends, some say that he was just a good teacher. But good teachers don't claim to be God. Some say he was merely a good example. But good examples don't hang out with prostitutes and sinners. Some say that he was a madman, but madmen don't flawlessly predict the future. Some say he was a fanatic, but crazed fanatics don't attract children and intellectuals to be their followers. Some say he was a religious phony, but phonies don't rise from the dead. Some say he was only a figment of people's imagination, but figments of imaginations aren't literally crucified. Some say that he was only a myth, but myths don't set the calendar for history. Some say he was an ideal man, an example of love, the highest model of religion, a pattern of virtue. But the angel said, he's Lord. He's Lord. Let me close by asking you that if you had your choice on that night, would you rather have been the angel or one of the shepherds? Some say, man, I'd want to be an angel. After all, it was angels who announced his birth. It was angels who came and strengthened him in his temptation. It was angels that ministered to him at Gethsemane. It was angels who rolled the stone away. But friend, I want to tell you, if I had my choice, I'd have rather been a shepherd. Because when it comes to the experience of salvation, angels only know that theoretically. We know it personally. Angels can only sing about joy. We can know joy. And as the great old hymn says, holy, holy is what the angels sing. And I expect to help them make the courts of heaven ring. But when I sing redemption's story, they will fold their wings, for angels never felt the joys that our salvation brings. I'd have rather been a shepherd, because I could have been saved by the grace of God and known experientially the joy of the Lord. Would you stand with me, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed, no one looking around. Friend, if you're here this morning and you've never given your heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ, you do not know the true meaning of Christmas, and you do not know what joy is about. And I strongly encourage you, plead with you, implore you, that after I pray in a moment, come forward and tell one of our counselors, one of our staff members here, that you would like to pray and ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart. If you're here today and you need a church home, man, we'd love to have you to be a part of our church family. You just need to pray. The altar's open to you. But Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for good news that brings great joy. Thank you for our Savior. who is so much more than just a little tiny baby, but he's Christ the Lord. Help us, I pray, to worship him with a true heart and a whole heart. And God, I pray for those who are here today who need to make spiritual decisions. There are those who need the Lord Jesus as their Savior. May they come today and receive him. And for those that need a church home, you've led them to this place. I pray that they would respond as well in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed and eyes closed. The choir is singing.